Okay. The next session, I'm going to talk about Kubernetes for Java developers, or maybe a little bit more interestingly, from zero to a Raspberry Pi cluster. This guy here, which I have. In not 60, not 50, but maybe 45 minutes. Let's see how it works out. We had some issues with the cable, so I hope that everything is fine. Okay, my name is Roland Huss. I'm working for Red Hat, as many others here as well. I'm also coming from the Fabricate team. I'm a software developer, and I'm also doing some open source. The most prominent one I'm working on is Jolokia. This is a JMX HTTP bridge. And yeah, but without further ado, let's start. So I want to take you today now from a journey. So the zero to a Kubernetes cluster, I mean that we really start without any container stuff, with plain microservices. And here is our road plan, how we want to go on. So first of all, there was this big thing, you know, all this monolith thing, and everybody, so there are people which are, who are lucky with monolith, but they have certain issues. We all know that if a lot of people are working on a big piece of software, there are a lot of communication needed to make the releases. You often see release cycles of half a year or even more, and it's a lot of overhead there. And then people got the idea, okay, why not break this down into several pieces. You already see that these are these new microservices where you have smaller parts which build up the big part. And what you can do now is, of course, you can tear these parts apart. And of course, the one problem here is that you go from a local system to a distributed system. This Clement talked on the Vertex tool, a lot of distributed systems who have a lot of issues here. But there are also other issues. Because now you can, the good thing is you can now split up this big team into smaller teams, and this is called so-called two pizza teams, and they can work in isolation on all the these microservices. But then they have also this new freedom, so they can choose now which kind of platform they want to have for running their applications on. And so things get a little bit fussy. So it's a dream for developers, but a nightmare for operations, of course, because if you think that you go to operation and you say, okay, you have to operate my Spring Boot application, my White Transform application, my Node.js, my Ruby, or maybe even Perl. This is really something your operations department is not really keen on. So what to do? And there's a very nice solution that you can say, okay, I put everything, these smaller parts into a thing called container, and this container have all the same surface, so they have all the same shape. And it doesn't matter what's happening within the container. The important thing is that from the outside, all the containers look the same. And this is something your operations team will love you for, because they have only now one platform they need to operate. And of course, you still have the distribution stuff, so the container needs to talk to each other. And the container technology, which is currently really the most prominent one, is Docker, of course. There are others, but Docker is probably the only one that's really it's the king of the containers. Well, now everything looks fine. You have your application microservice in the container, operations is happy, and your development team is happy because they can do the things like they want to do. But then you think, okay, then I have not only these four containers, but I have a lot of containers. So you need to operate them, or people say to orchestrate them. And not only on a single host, but you want to put them onto a whole fleet of hosts, so a lot of nodes are required for that one. And it's important that you don't exactly know where your microservice is running now, but it can be running anywhere. And to manage these complexity, there are tools, and one of the prominent tool is Kubernetes, which is the orchestration platform. If you were there yesterday, and also maybe today, you have heard a lot about Kubernetes. So Kubernetes is one of the one orchestration platform on top of Docker. There are, of course, different orchestration platforms like Swarm or Mesos, but today I'm going to talk about Kubernetes. And this is now our journey. So we are going now from this, so we skip the step of breaking up the monolith, but we start with microservices, bring them into Docker containers, so that there are nice images for this, and then we take these images and put them on the Kubernetes. And the Kubernetes cluster itself is now here, this four node Raspberry Pi cluster, more on this layer. Okay, let's start with the beginning. Who knows this game? Who has played it really in life? So with a real console, not only in the emulator? Ah, okay, there are still a hi, old guys, so we are from the same age. Okay, this is probably this is the very first sports arcade game, if you say it like this. So it's a predecessor of EA Sports, FIFA, whatever. And this comes from 1972. And yeah, it's a very big dinosaur monolith, and so we need to break this down into two services. We use two microservices, and they are called Ping and Pong. So Pong is a server. We will realize it, making it white flies wrong. And Ping is a client which throws the ball to the Pong service, and it gets back simply a result whether Pong has hit the ball or whether he missed it. And then this goes in the second round with Ping throwing the ball again. If the Ping haven't missed the ball, and as long as some one of them simply lose the round, the game. So now let's have a look how it's set up. Okay, have long arms. I have here the demo. I have here the ping pong. This ping we now ignore for the moment. Let's have a look at the pong service as first. So this is a JAX-RS web service. You see here that I have several classes. So we have this typical REST application, Java, which is simply an annotated entry class. And then we have endpoints, and the important endpoint is this Pong endpoint. So let me see. So it's, sorry, it listens on a context Pong. Then you have a parameter, which is the ID. So the client sends an ID with his request. And then in this Pong, then we simply play the game, which is very simplistic play game, or very sophisticated, as you depends on your point of view, of course. And then we return our own ID, which is a randomly generated UUID at the beginning, and then we start with this job. Just a quick look at this job itself. So Java, so this is highly sophisticated stuff, so it simply have some random number with rated with some things which you can set also and return either hit or missed. So this is the server part. And now we go to the client. It's a little bit more complicated because of the so this, as I said, the Ping itself is a Spring Boot client, so we have here application, it's annotated with the Spring Boot application. Rihanna, there's a simple client component. Okay, just only the high level. First, there's some configuration. You see that, so Whitefly Swarm, the server starts by default, localhost at port 8080. We can configure this on later. This becomes important when we go to the to containers and to the platform. We have some other configuration and sorry, and then we get the URL is simply the host, the port, and then the component. And when we start, or this is a thread which runs forever. Sorry, here we have a number of strokes. We start, we send a request, and then we evaluate the result of the request. Then we make our own stroke, and either when we miss, then the game is over. Otherwise, it continues until some of the either ping or either pong misses the game. So okay, now let's see it in action. So I start first the server. So I have to use Whitefly Swarm run. So I make it a little bit in the background. Time to lock something. Here it simply starts up. There was Wi-Fi swarm, so it takes a little bit because it needs to construct this microservice, which in fact is not so small. So it's not really a microservice in size. So it's maybe 50 megabytes or so because it has all this Java the Undertow web server within it. Okay, now we go to Ping, and here we start Spring Boot run. Also, the Spring Boot is a little bit smaller. It's maybe only a third of Wi-Fi Swarm at the moment, but there are also still 15 gigabytes there. So here's now our game. Starts here. We have a little bit. It takes a little bit. Okay. No connection, so Wi-Fi Swarm is a little bit slower to come up. So there's some resilience included there in this very nice game. Okay. Now it starts, and you see. Just stop it. In a second. So we see it here, for example, there's a game where we have three rounds, throw the ball to Pong, Pong returns with a hit, and so long until the client, King, misses the ball. That's it. And what we have now is a set of two microservices working in localhost, so they are starting both on the same server, they are communicating over localhost port 8080. And in the next step now, we are going to put them into some Docker images containers and run them from there. So, Docker, some words of Docker, who doesn't know Docker? Okay, I have a little bit of intro, it's not really, it's only very for the surface. So the thing with Docker is that it's a container-based virtualization, OS-level-based virtualization. And this is different of the virtualization we normally know with virtual machines, because it's not something where a complete hardware is simulated by this technology. So you don't have some sort of hypervisor where you put very fat virtual machines like VirtualBox or other one on top of this. But you merely have some sort of isolation. So you put your application into some cage where you have simply isolated various aspects like CPU, like the network, like the file system. So, and because of this, it's much lighter and faster. So because you don't have to start or emulate a complete hardware, you simply have to set up this isolation boundaries, which are normally only simple Unix calls. And therefore, it starts very, very quickly, and you can put hundreds of Docker virtual machines or Docker containers, as it is called, onto a single host in the port. So this is the thing with Docker. With this name, with this isolation, this is container stuff, and Docker makes it also easy to handle this. So containers are really known since 10 years or even longer. But it was only Docker who introduced a very nice user experience on top of this. So we have a command line interface how you can create these images and so on. So here it looks like how such a Docker image is created. You have a Docker file, which is more or less a sort of script with certain instructions. And you can have some sort of base image, which you can download from somewhere, so from Docker Hub, or you can. So you have some sort of inheritance within this Docker world. And then you have several comments, so in that case I make some update, I add a microservice chart which I have created somewhere, expose a certain port, and then I say this microservice should be started when the container is created. You can build it with this CLI tool, as I said, Docker build is a very nice thing to build this. This is all fine if you want to do it everything manually, but if you want to integrate it into your build process, it's not, of course, not so cool, because you need this external CLI stuff, so you need Docker installed. Much better is to have something like a Maven plugin, or if you use Maven, of course, then you can really integrate it very tightly in your build process. And it's very, because your build already has some knowledge where your artifact which you create is located, for example, or other stuff, you can benefit from this information and create your images. And you can. It's also cool that it is versioned and that you don't need any Docker client. Okay, so now let's put our microservice into the container. So there I am going to the Pink microservice, if you look only at one. Let's have a look in the Maven build script, in the POM XML. So I have to scroll down a little bit, sorry. Okay, if here now a Docker Maven plugin, this is also done by the Fabricate team and maintained. And here you see you have a configuration where you have an image, images have names. You have a base image here, put a property from Maven, which is declared up further on the top of the POM XML. and then you're in the moment to start it. And the cool thing is that you don't have to put a path to your artifact, to your target directory where a jar is lying, but you simply say, okay, I want the artifact which is attached to this bit. So it's quite good combined there. Okay, we build it here. Maven, so I have to call it Maven package Docker build. Okay, takes a little bit. So also mostly because you need to move around certain jar files. And here you see in color that it creates an image in 3 seconds and isn't this idea. I did this already for POM, and what I do can now is if I look here at the top level POM, there I have also a configuration for this plugin, which you can see here. And here I can start both images at once and connect them together. What is interesting here, I use a so-called network link of Docker. In that case, I say that the ping image to join the network space of the POM image, so they have the same network space. So this is all the technique, by the way, but we will say it's CLater pods who also combine certain containers together. This is the same technique how pods can share their network space. And now I'm running simply called Docker run, maybe Docker run. And essentially the same is happening now as before, but now from within Docker images. Sorry, this was, I better call it minus N, and then I can set, because I want only the top level POM, and then I can set a property, maybe let's do it like that. I can look now the distorted, but our images are running here as containers, and I can now go into this container here, for example, and look at the doc logs, and then I can say minus F for follow, look at the container, and you see that the game is going on at the moment, so, but in the background, because I started the images in the background. Okay, now let's continue. Now this was now the Docker part, but now finally to the interesting stuff. We are now at the point where we want to bring our Docker images onto this orchestration platform Kubernetes. Kubernetes itself is an open source orchestration system for Docker containers. It was invented and is also maintained mostly by Google. Google has used a lot of their previous experiences with container systems. They had internally a system called Borg, and this they brought all the experiences they made there to the open source, and so Kubernetes now is maybe 2 years old or so. And it has a lot of nice features. So it has a scheduling capability that your images really get distributed over different nodes, for example. It has a way of horizontal scaling that you can simply add new nodes, and the containers which you start then afterwards are distributed over all nodes. One very important point of Kubernetes is that it is a declarative system, so you say you declare the state you want to have with Kubernetes, and if the state, for example, if one container dies for some reason, it will restart this container again on your own because it knows he needs 3 containers of this kind, then it periodically checks whether there are 3, and if this is not the case, it simply spins up a new one, so it's self-healing. It provides a nice way to discover services, we will see it in a minute, and allows automated rollout and rollbacks. So this means you can deploy your application in a way so that you have a rolling update in such a way that your application doesn't go down. What is the architecture? It's quite simple. You have nodes here. On these nodes are Docker daemons, and they on these nodes, all the Docker daemons start Docker containers. You squares. The nodes communicate with the master communicates with the node, so it's a bidirectional communication here. And you have a command line tool, kubectl or kubectl, as the Google guys call it, this thing itself, which talks about the REST interface to the master. So this master is also an API server, so you have a REST protocol, and you can call this kubectl from every other, from another system, for example. Okay, this is Kubernetes on a 10,000 feet view. Now a little bit to this cluster, which I have here. That's a quite nice quite setup. You can get the whole cluster for not much more than €300. What you need is, of course, Raspberry Pis. You can take more or less, so you should use at least two, of course. What's interesting here, that this is a Raspberry Pi 3, which has the nice feature that they have an internal Wi-Fi chip on board. And this is important because if you know the Raspberry Pi 2 and the other ones, all the I.O. traffic are going over the USB bus. So they share all the same bus. If you go over Ethernet, for example, and you want to write on the disk, then you have this USB 2 bus, which has not much more than 20 megabytes per second. But if you use an external Wi-Fi, this has an extra dedicated I.O. channel. So the full bandwidth of the USB bus is now available for your disk I.O. You need some USB charger, you can buy some SD cards, so 32 is already quite large, you can also use smaller cards. And also important, you don't really need the most fastest cards. It's also sufficient if you have a normal level 10 card, which has up to 40-50 megabytes per second. If you're interested, I have the detailed setup, I brought also with links to where you can buy such things found on my blog here. Now we have this cluster, but of course the important question is how you get Kubernetes onto this cluster. There are different projects who make this. I decided to use Ansible for provisioning Kubernetes on this cluster. Who knows Ansible? Okay, a few. So Ansible is a configuration management system much like Puppet, Chef, or Sort. So it's something where you can simply declare the target state of your system, and Ansible checks that it really has all the software on it. So it's really something like that. And this, of course, we can use Ansible for deploying Kubernetes on this. At the moment, so some technical terms, won't go into too much detail here. So this Ansible playbooks, which is also available on GitHub, uses a flannel overlay network. So it's used to know that the pods themselves, you will see the concept in a minute, can speak on a software-defined network. It has a Sky DNS installed for service discovery, and currently I'm working on the next thing, that the Docker registry will be there soon, and also some ingress controller for routing traffic from the outside. And I also managed to compile OpenShift for ARM, because that's the next challenge, really, to get the software for ARM platform. It's not so easy. Luckily, Kubernetes itself, they release ARM binaries on their own, so if you can go to Kubernetes and download all the ARM binaries yourself, but the other add-ons like Flannel or HD or other things, you have to compile, probably cross-compile on your own. And then you can only, of course, run images which are ARM-based on these machines, of course. You can't go to Docker Hub and use an arbitrary Intel image and put it on the ARM, so you need dedicated Docker images for the ARM. Okay, now to some concepts, which we all now play with the Kubernetes cluster. You have there a pod. A pod is the atom of Kubernetes. So, pod is an atom of Kubernetes, which means that there's nothing smaller than a pod on Kubernetes. And a pod contains one or more containers. So it typically or often only contains one container, but it can also contain more than one. And these containers all share the same network space and file system. Why it is like this? One big advantage of this setup is that you can easily put so-called sidecar containers into the pod. A sidecar container is a container which provides some additional, mostly infrastructure features to the application, like pushing on the log to a centralized logging server for cyclic file system and so on. So you can enhance your application with some sort of extra functionality by putting extra pods into extra containers into our pod. Here you see that there are names on the pod, the Docker images names, and they are pulled from our registry. Another important concept is that each pod gets a dedicated IP address. And so what you have in a pod with this IP address, okay, it is ephemeral, which means if, when a pod goes down and comes up again, then it gets a different IP address. The good thing is that your application is now free to open any port without risking to get into some collision. You know, Docker has a concept of mapping ports to the outside, so if you want, if you run a Tomcat within a Docker container which exports or which binds to 8080, then you have to map this one to a certain port on your local host where a Docker daemon is running. Here it is different because you got own IP addresses, so you don't you are really free to open the original port there. Another concept are these labels, which you have seen here. This, which means you can give any object in Kubernetes own labels, key-value pairs, and you are free how to choose them. You will see in a minute that labels are important for defining services, for example, or for so-called selectors. As I said, it's free form, so you're free to choose what you like. Now let's create our first pod. So, we create first our server. So we have here a definition file for Kubernetes for creating resources. In that, in this example, it's a pod. And these resource descriptors all look the same. So you have an API version on top, then you define the kind. So the API itself for Kubernetes is very generic. So you always create certain resource objects like pods, services, and so on. And these are defined by the kind. You attach some sort of metadata to these objects. And that there's the specification. In that case, I give the pod a name, I attach some labels to it, and then I specify which containers should run in this pod. In that case, only one container is running, and it's taken from that image which is specified here. I also specify the port which is exposed. How you can create the pod, so just have a look at this. Is now our cluster, how it looks like. So we have four nodes here, and I'm creating pure control. This is the command line tool, create minus f pod YAML. Now a pod is created, and then reload. You have now a pod here. So you see, this is pod has a name, POM, and then it's running on the second node, this N2, which means all the nodes are named in N0 to up to N3. And of course, I can delete this one. Okay, not so. So this was our first, this was our first pod. Now let's continue to the next concept, which is a replication controller, or as it is called nowadays, a replica set. So replication controller is quite lengthy to type, so it's often shortened to be only RC. But in the newest version in Kubernetes 1.3, they have introduced the concept of a replica set, which has a little bit of richer feature set, but it's more or less the same as a replication controller. And this replication controller is responsible for managing pods. So when I create a pod by hand, as I did just now, if I kill it, then the pod is gone. So nobody is going to start it again. Therefore, you need replication controllers, which are responsible to really to check periodically that exactly the pods you have specified are really running. How does a replication controller do this? He has a label selector to select a certain set of pods. You give it a replica count, and this selector matches 1, 2, 3, 4 pods, and this number of matched pods must match the replica count. If there are less pods than the replica count specifies, then it fires new pods. And how does it know what pods it should create? Therefore, the replication controller has a sort of template in its definition for creating new pods. You see the replication controller in action in a minute. So here's a a picture replication controller, in that case is responsible for three pods, has an selector for name POM version 1, and I have now here three pods, which these are IP addresses, all with this name POM version 1. So, but you are completely free how you choose these labels. So, let's check that one. Okay, as I said, replication controller, again, this is the type is specified at the top. Then you have metadata, you have here, it's important, the selector, and then you have a template. The content of this template is more or less the same as the specification of a port, as you have seen in the slide before. Okay, we are creating that one. Go to the slide, and now we see here. Okay, it doesn't matter. This I specified a replication count of 1. I create the controller, and this controller immediately picked up the already existing server. So that had not need to create a new one. If I now rescale, I can. There's a K severe shortcut I introduced here. I can use scale and say replicas, let's say 3, for the replication controller named POM. Go back here, make a redirect. Then you immediately, 2 new pods has been spun up. You see now here, they are on different nodes, so there are some load balancing here. And if one of these pods dies, for example, because I'm now plugging this power cable here for node 3, you will see that node 3 will go red in a second. Just postpone this demo for a second and have a look at this rolling update, which I'm going to show you then also. What you do is you create a second replication. When you do a rolling update, this means that you want, when you have a rolling update, you want to stay your old application and you deploy a new application. And what happens here is you create temporarily a new replication controller. And then everything is scaled, as the old application is scaled down step by step from 3 to 1, whereas the new replication controller scales up from 1 to 3, so that you have really a continuous rolling update. And it's upscaled to the new replication controller. Okay. Here we go. We can check our pods, and you see that all the pods I have created previously are still there. So this is really persistent store there, even if the server goes down. There is some distributed store. It's called etcd, which is called a distributed key value store. This is running on all the nodes. So even if the master node goes down and the master node goes up, then it gets back the state of the whole cluster. And also, it's also important, the master normally is not something which is provided in high availability mode, because the whole application has to keep running even if the master is not there. The only thing which you cannot do is to create new objects or manage these objects, but the applications themselves are still running even if the master is down. This is also important to know. So, now let's... Okay, here we see everything is here like before. And we have still this node 3. Should I do that at the end? Next try. Okay, now let's check this service demo. So go to Kubernetes. So have a look at the service, but as I said, it's simply not much more than a selector. Okay, and here's something. I have a port, which is the port on the containers. In that case, port 8080. And I want to expose the service port also as 8080. But this is all happening within the cluster. This cluster has IP addresses which are not routable, so you cannot access it from the outside. And there are several ways how you can expose the service to the outside. One of them is to use a load balancer. So if you use Kubernetes, for example, or Google Container Engine, they provide for you automatic a load balancer. If not, you can either install an own load balancer on your own, or you can use the so-called node port mode, where the port, this node port, this 3333, is exposed on every node. So if I do this, create the service, then I can access my application on every node from the outside over this port. So let's create it. Service YAML. Okay, so there are some warnings that it's not really an optimal mode to do that. And if I go now to this URL and I call my service, then you see that I'm really, and I can choose any node. So if I go here for, let's say, if I go to node 1, for example, I have the same result. And this matches. And what you see here now in the overview that a service has been created, and it also matches now everything of this Okay, now we have our server, and the next step is to create a replication controller for our client, which is Ping. Again, I don't show you the resource file. You see, it's more or less the same as for. So, what you see here now, we have one single replication controller called Ping. Smaller. Okay. Ping, and this uses the service pong. And how does it find, so how does Ping find the service pong? This is quite easy, because Kubernetes injects the service IP address via environment variables to the client. So when I start on a new pod, then it gets all the services which has been created as environment variables. You can see this in the source code. Sorry.
source manager, da, 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 da. Ping up the client. So here you see, it's a wide rubble variable which is used by the Spring Boot, which is by default localhost, gets set now by Kubernetes with this name. So Pong is the name of the service I have created, and then this, we have this fixed service host and service port, which also gets set on by Kubernetes. You can easily verify this. If you, for example, look at the pods, we go into one of the running pods. You can use kubectl exec for that. So it's ping o.io. Here you see a lot of these services. Yeah. And if we do a and web Pong, you see that the Pong service now here is running on this IP address. Okay? Well, this is how it works. We exit that one. And now let's check out a rolling update. In that case, I might have rolling update from the client. Can be easily done. Rolling update means test 2. We run it here. So there's a dedicated command, kubectl rolling update, and the rolling update features are pure client features. So the client itself now makes different API calls for doing the rolling update thing. So it's good to look here. So what's happening now? Okay, sorry. A new application controller is created. You see here the new versions v2, which are three pieces, because I said I want three in the new update. Then the old ping is scaled down and the application controller is removed. So it's a little bit fast, but you get the idea, I think. This is a thing, and everything is now running here now I have three clients and I can do a rollback quite easily. I simply do reverse this operation. So if we look at, for example, logs of this new application, let's say it's that one here. Oops, okay, some issue. Okay, you see that the new one has not started. A lot of exceptions. In that case, you simply can roll back to the old one. So again, I have an application controller. You create now, so you have, so two are, in that case, two, because the old replication only specifies a single pod. Two are killed, then a new one is created. These will vanish soon, and then you're back to the original state. But this, teardown takes a little bit because there is some sort of grace period to allow your application to tear down gracefully. Okay, and now we can hopefully we are good here. Logs, we are doing that one. So we are back our code here. So the new version was shitty, so we can back to the old one. Okay. Now I have 5 minutes left, or? Yeah, probably. There are some advanced features still. There are volumes, which I'm not going to show you now, but you have different type of volume management volumes, which you can use to add persistent state to your applications. So it's the same. So volume is also a Kubernetes object, which you can attach. There are, as I said, various kinds. You can have local storage, where you can put your data on the local nodes, for example. Then you have, of course, distributed network storage, which is the usual case, because of course you are not sure where your pod is running, and if you want to access the same data when the pod is restarted, and this pod starts on a different node, so you need some sort of distributed volumes. You have other concepts like config maps, where you can have some parameterization for your applications. You can use service accounts for accessing the API server from your own application.
and other things. Health and lightness check, so this has been told, explained yesterday. So Kubernetes itself is quite complete. It has a lot of nice things to focus on. You see, even if a very stupid user like me makes everything wrong, it comes back up normally after some minutes. So it's quite good. And for the last 5 minutes, maybe I skip this. You have already seen this OpenShift stuff, which is on which is on top of Kubernetes. So OpenShift itself is based on Kubernetes. It's an application provided from Red Hat. There's an open source version called OpenShift Origin, but of course you can also the enterprise version if you like. And it's different from OpenShift to Kubernetes. This is something often it's not so easy to explain. But there are a certain extra services provided by OpenShift. For example, OpenShift adds some sort of build capabilities on top of Kubernetes. So you can simply specify for OpenShift, here are my source code. I want to use this Maven builder image, and now please go fetch the source code, create your application within OpenShift, and then deploy it for you. So this is something Kubernetes does not for you. It's, and then it has some developer tools, extra infrastructure services like registry, router, security is important, so you have a single sign-on system within OpenShift. The volume management is, as I said, you can use it, Kubernetes, but you have to provide this volume manager who is doing this. This can be quite complicated, and OpenShift makes this also for you. You have multi-tenancy, and you have also some sort of management UI. Here are some picture, but it's a different, so you have so everything in OpenShift, again, are new objects. Cool thing about Kubernetes is that the API I have shown you is where you create certain kind of objects is quite extensible, so you can hook your own stuff easily into Kubernetes, and OpenShift simply hooks in new things like image streams or build configuration, source to image, and so forth. Okay, final words, but I don't will not tell much about Fabricated because it has already covered quite a lot in the conference. What is Fabricate? Fabricate is, for example, these plugins we have seen. We have seen this Docker Maven plugin. But it's also a microservice platform, so it helps you bring your microservices onto Kubernetes in OpenShift. This is one of the newest definition of Fabricate. Then there are some themes. There's continuous delivery. There's a management UI. You have a lot of quick starts, how you can really have some very good examples, how you can create, for example, Camel applications for Kubernetes. And also for the tooling. And finally, there is a new plugin. So this Fabricate plugin, okay, it's cut off here. It's an extension on top of the Docker Maven plugin we just have seen. So the Docker Maven plugin is useful for creating Docker images. With Fabricate, you can build these images, but you can also create this resource descriptor, which I have shown you, where you have these YAML files. These descriptors can also be created from your build information. And what we do here, we support descriptors and we can enrich them with certain labels and other information on top of them. It's quite new, it's not really production ready now, the new version of the Fabricate Maven plugin, you find an older one, which also works great, but it's done in a different way. And now, okay, this was Fabricate, OpenShift, so we had now a really quick tour through all the concepts of Kubernetes with this Raspberry Pi cluster. And the wrap-up is that Docker alone typically is not enough. You need to think about how you can operate them in a way which really also scales. So you need an orchestration platform. One of the orchestration platforms available is Kubernetes. And it's quite easy to use. It's not so easy to set up, I have to say. So setting up Kubernetes on your own is a little bit tricky because there are a lot of parts which you need to combine. But using this, I hope I could convince you that it's really quite easy to use Kubernetes. And you get really enterprise-grade features, like really super stable applications which come back even after some kind of stuff. It's rock solid. It's very hard to break Kubernetes in some way. And finally, this setting up with Raspberry Pi, I really can recommend it because it's quite nice to have some physical thing there where you really can plug cables, and even if they are the wrong cables, you can really plug something and plug it back. It's quite nice, so I really can recommend to play around with this Raspberry Pi cluster. Okay, that's it. Are there questions? Yeah?
You mentioned the sidecar pattern at the beginning. We're using this pattern for the logs and the stuff there.
is really you realize it to put it in the same pod. The good thing is there's share really the same file system and the same port space, so there's nothing where you need to map something or something else. So they're very close to each other. And this is so typically, I think pod were invented exactly for this use case. So you put your sidecar directly in the pod. Any other questions? Okay, if not, there will be, I have all the slides, including this terminal stuff and all the thing, are available also as a Docker container. You can run it yourself if you like. You can download it. There's also a base image where you can create your own RevealJS based application with this. This URL is a little bit outdated. It's an older version of this presentation, but I will, so if you follow me on Twitter, I will Twitter you when there's a URL. Okay, then thank you.